if I could ask you all to take your seat, that's going to be the best way that we have of getting some people who are waiting outside in the cold who really want to see the panel. Please take your seat if you could. We're going to begin very shortly. Thank you.
we are connected now.
I can hear everything you're saying.
Yeah.
You don't look like Ray to me.
Falling apart. Is that mine?
Oh my god.
It was mine.
What did you do? No, no, that's okay.
I have gained weight, I know that.
It's just broken, you know,
yeah, it's broken.
Broken.
It's broken.
It's just broken.
I think, John, we may need another chair for Bob also.
Thank you. You got it? Thank you.
Okay.
Hey, Steph. Yeah. Let me hand my jacket over after all. Thank you, sweetie. Can we go?
We'll get him on. Do I have the okay to go? I'm going, right? I have no power in this place. Can I go, John? Yeah. Well, I think Bob's going to speak, and then he's going to sit in the house. I gave him all my surprises. Anyway, here we are for the power of story. My name's John Cooper. Hey.
Hello, darling.
I'm going to be very quick with this. I'm the director of the festival. One thing that this is power of story. We do two big panels a year. Obviously, it's to show the power of story in changing things and talking about both our industry and the world we live in. And this is part of it. And I don't have to do the intro because I have two very handsome young men. I've been trying to wedge myself into this family for 28 years. I haven't done it quite yet, but I have two Redfords here, Jamie Redford and Robert Redford.
Hey, everybody. Great to be here. And you know, I know I speak for everyone that works with me at the Redford Center when I say we're really honored to be invited by the Sundance Institute to come in with them and work on this new climate initiative. This is an inaugural event, and we're really honored to do it as a nonprofit media company that both supports and produces content to engage and inspire. This is right up our alley, and we really look forward to seeing where this goes, and I think it's going to go big places. It's also my honor to be introducing my father, who, you know, who 10 years ago helped me both envision and launch the Redford Center, and has continued to be supportive and a source of real inspiration to us, and for me, obviously, my whole life, a source of inspiration, as he has been, I'm sure, for a lot of you in this room. So, and I can remember, actually, I do remember as a small boy when his passions turned to protecting the environment. And it's been decades, and he has not let up one inch in all that time. So, without any further ado, let's, as he's known around here, let's welcome Bob.
Well, thank you, James. The subject for this year is change, and I can apply that to my own family. Jamie in particular, when he was very, very little, his whole objective in life seemed to be to destroy everything I was trying to do. And he grew out of that, thank God. And so when you think about when you're a parent and you think about raising a child, I'm speaking for myself anyway, but you're gonna guide them because you have to guide them because they're little and they need education and they need guidance, and it starts at home. And so obviously you get obsessed with values. You wanna make sure that whatever values you were given by your parents gets passed on to your children. So you try to pass those values on, but at a certain point they're on their own. And so in Jamie's case, and there are other members of my family here as well, but in Jamie's case, to watch him develop and grow and find his own path, I mean, he went in many different directions for a while, but finally things centered out and he found his path. When he got on his path, he got on his own. And that is what I celebrate. I celebrate the fact that he has become his own person. He's on his own path. And that path kind of speaks for itself, which you will all see in terms of the films that, that he's now making. For this gathering, I would say probably, obviously, change is the word. And I think change, one of the things, you know, we started in starting this festival, the idea was to create a place and a home for new filmmakers who had stories to tell who weren't being given a chance to have a place to come to and create a home for them and let their stories be told, and hopefully those stories would go out and beyond. So I think I'm happy to say, I think after 30 some odd years that that has happened. So the festival now really kind of speaks for itself. And looking at the themes that come out of the festival, obviously this year climate comes up. And that's a pretty big word. And I think what we've had to deal with is a combination, a certain amount of resistance to talking about it, let alone acting on it. And I think that's slowly changing. I think that resistance either was due to either opposition or apathy, whatever. But I think that's been broken through now because the evidence is just all too clear. And I remember when I started trying to talk about this 40 years ago, it was way too early. And that's when I realized that timing is everything, and sometimes timing has to come to you. You can't push it. But trying to warn people about something you saw, and if it's not the right timing, it's just not going to happen. So I'm happy to say that finally this subject has come about full force, and it's become a major topic. And of course, it has the usual resistors, but I think that resistance is now going to be overcome because I think the people are going to get involved in the way they didn't before. And I think they're going to create a movement. I think that movement is going to overwhelm opposition. I'm not only hopeful, I believe that. So having said that, I would like to now, am I introducing my son James?
No.
Am I introducing?
Rhymes with James.
I'm sorry?
Rhymes with Jamie. Amy.
Amy. I have a daughter named Amy too, but come on up, Amy.
Well,
Amy Goodman.
I think we'll just sit in our seats as long as they don't collapse under us, and begin this discussion. We had lunch before, and I was just commenting, I'm a little in awe of being in the presence of three presidents of sovereign nations in the front row. Well, this week, I just came from last night, covering the protests and the inauguration of the 45th president of the United States. In the front row is the 45th tribal chairman of the Standing Rock Sioux, David Archambault. Woo! We'll be hearing from him in a bit. And on the stage, President Mohamed Nasheed of the Maldives, well, two presidents on the stage who were really had their presidencies taken from them. President Nasheed was forced out of the presidency in 2012 with a gun to his head in a coup in a country we've all come to know as on the front lines of climate change, the Maldives. And he's become such an eloquent spokesperson at UN climate summit after summit until he was forced out. And, well, Vice President Al Gore, who I think has become particularly powerful spokesperson after his position of power in the government. And that's going to be the focus of what we're going to talk about today. The power of movements to tell their stories, to ensure that we hear what people who are making history have to say. And that's the role of an independent media and all the media, to go to where the silence is, to ensure that Well, I see the media as a huge kitchen table that we all sit around and debate and discuss the most important issues of the day, war and peace, life and death, and anything less than that is a disservice to a democratic society. So this weekend, being in Washington, what we saw on Saturday was astonishing, not only in DC, but all over the country, well over a million people making their voices heard, their dissent commonplace, and not only their voices in the United States, but all over the world in well over 600 cities, towns, and hamlets. And when I flew in last night to Park City, watching the networks with those know-nothing pundits who know so little about so much explaining the world to us, instead focusing on a tweet, focusing on a tweet of the president, who is deeply concerned that the New York Times had tweeted out two pictures alongside each other. One of the inauguration of President Trump, the size of the audience, and one of the inauguration of President Obama. The tweet of the President of the United States, deeply concerned that people understood that the size of his inaugural audience was not only larger than Obama's, but larger than any president in history and anyone in the world. That became the main topic of discussion last night in the media when you had these historic moments of resistance and people making their voices heard in the Women's March. So here today, we'll equalize the playing field and we'll hear from people who are documenting those who are speaking out or who are speaking out themselves. And so I wanted to begin with Heather Ray, who I last saw in North Dakota in covering with other Native American filmmakers, Heather Ray covering the standoff at Standing Rock. And Heather, in the first, your opening comments, if you can talk about what is happening there, and not only what is happening there, but the people you are working with to tell that story.
Well, I want to say first that I'm so happy to be here, and I really appreciate being invited to, you know, to sit with this, you know, this group of people and to be here with you all today. I'm not a spokesperson for Standing Rock. I think that the best person to speak to the reality of what's happening is the chairman. And I also don't speak for the movement. I'm a media maker. I did go in August in response to the call, you know, from the community asking for support and asking for solidarity. Like many of us went there early on, essentially to fight a pipeline. But by nature of, you know, being media makers and storytellers, I mean, I really don't have any other skills. I'm a filmmaker, although I make good pies. and so I went, essentially in solidarity with the, you know, with the indigenous community at large in the Western Hemisphere. And there were, you know, several hundred tribes represented in that movement, and there were people from all over the world represented in that movement. But one of the things that happened there, Amy, you know, to your question, is that there were a number of us that were there that were Native media makers in the beginning, and that was really how the story was being told. I mean, it wasn't until things began to get violent that we really began to see the presence of, you know, more generalized news media, and so the beginning of the movement and the story was coming from a group of us that were really in many ways working in solidarity with one another with a sense of great responsibility to be in service to this story and be in service to the movement. And in a lot of ways, as media makers and storytellers, we found ourselves very much woven into the narrative. So we weren't there in an anthropological context. We're there in a context that was very much rooted in what it means to be in the experience of being in a resistance movement and to be fighting for your families and the generations to come and to be fighting for water and for this land and our ability to sustain ourselves on this planet. So there was it ran very deep, what the experience of being there. Mm.
I wanted to turn to Mohamed Nasheed. In January 18th, just a few days ago, marked the first anniversary of your release from jail.
Or rather, escape from jail.
Yeah. Your escape from jail. Months before the 2009 UN Climate Summit, you made international headlines when you held a cabinet meeting underwater. To bring attention to the dire consequences of global warming. Along with other government and cabinet ministers, you wore scuba gear and plunged nearly 20 feet into the Indian Ocean. You were president until 2012, when you escaped, when a gun was put to your head. But that hasn't stopped you from speaking out on the issue of climate change. Can you tell us about what happened to you and what you're doing to change the climate, not only of your country, but of the world, in every sense of the word?
Well, thank you very much, and it's a pleasure to be here and with this panel and also speaking to you. The Maldives is just a meter above the sea level. And any change in ocean level sea levels will have a very big impact on the Maldives. For us, it's already happening. It's not something that is going to happen in the future. So we should be bracing ourselves for more adaptation measures than trying to mitigate further change. And the type of adaptation that is required for the Maldives and many other low-lying islands is very, very expensive. And therefore, we must find low-cost, more biological adaptation measures that would help us to survive. I want to point out, climate change has very often been taken as an ethical issue and a human rights issue, and so it should be. But I think it's also very important to see climate change as an economic issue. In my view, the market mechanism and the profit motive can fix the world. I understand that it is through these mechanisms that we've come to where we are, but I think it is also possible to find solutions through the market. The technology is out there, it's new, and I believe that a low carbon development strategy is possible. Very often, developed country leaders assume that carbon emission is equal to development. But I have a view that the fossil fuel development model is obsolete, it's Victorian, it's very old. It's cumbersome, it's big, it's dirty, and I believe that the new technology is far more efficient, and we would be able to have a better life by embracing the new technology. Now, if you are unable to embrace the new technology, you of course cannot be the leaders of tomorrow. Amy was asking me what has happened to me. Well, many things have happened to me. but I believe that we must keep going, and we cannot give up. We should not give up, and I'm certain that I will not ever give up. Vice President Al Gore's new film, there is so much hope. There is so much that can be done. And every challenge that we face, I would like to see it as an opportunity.
President Nasheed, this panel is about the power of storytelling, so I don't want you to get out of telling your own story briefly. It is such an important one and inspires so many people, especially young people. If you could briefly...
Well, okay, I started my life, my working life. I started my working life as a journalist, and then I started writing. This was back in 1989, and every time I wrote, they arrested me. And then every time they would release me again, and then I would write again. And then I would be arrested again. I've been tortured twice. I've been, many things have been done to me, but I don't, you know, you don't want these details in the storytelling. But then finally, I thought that I might have some safety and security if I were to be able to become a politician. So I contested for a parliamentary seat. Strangely enough, I won it. And then I got arrested again for having won that seat. So that didn't really quite work out. Then I went into exile abroad, and then we started a political party in exile, first in Sri Lanka, Colombo, and then later on in Salisbury, England. We were able to galvanize our people to political activism. We were able to amend our constitution. And I returned back home, and I was fortunate to have won that election, and I became the president. We did not want to arrest the former government, but that's what usually happens in the Maldives. By every change of government, you would usually arrest the last government and torture them. But we thought that if we can move away from that circle of things, it might help our people, and we might be able to move forward rather than going for a witch hunt. But unfortunately, the previous government came back, and now the former president's brother is the president. But I would still think that we've not gone back to where we were before. We've been able to come up with some structures of political parties and independent institutions, and some of these institutions are still surviving. And I am hopeful that we can get our country back on track again. Now, how I connect this with climate change is, in my view, the most important adaptation measure is democracy. Vice President Al Gore again was talking in his film that we would have to have this discussion. We will not be able to have this discussion without democracy, and also we would be making the wrong investments without proper governance. We would be building the wrong revetment at the wrong place, at the wrong with the wrong price, and the wrong people would be doing it. So it's, for me, the most important adaptation issue is good governance. That's where my story lies right now.
I'm going to be jumping around this panel here. The title of a whole track here at Sundance is The New Climate, in every sense of the word. And I thought no better person to address this than someone who won a Nobel Peace Prize for his environmental activism and an Academy Award for the film about him, The Inconvenient Truth. I know that the current president of the United States has called for the Nobel Committee to rescind that Peace Prize because of your focus on climate change. And Vice President Gore, I wanted to ask you about the latest developments. We have a new president who's chosen for his cabinet, a man he himself calls, as Secretary of State, Mr. Exxon. And just this week, in the pre-inaugural activities and addressing over 100 diplomats, he was looking for Rex Tillerson, the former CEO of the largest private oil corporation in the world, ExxonMobil. He was looking for him in the audience. And he said, Rex, where are you? And he turned to the diplomats and said, he's led this charmed life. He goes into a country, takes the oil, goes into another country. It's tough dealing with these politicians, right? He said. And then on Saturday, President Trump, his first visit was to the CIA, where he stood in front of the Wall of the Fallen, those CIA officials or agents who died in action. He mainly focused on the size of his inaugural audience. But he did talk about his plans and looked back in history. He was there with his hope for the head of the CIA, Congressmember Mike Pompeo. But he told the CIA officials that when the United States went into Iraq, we should have kept the oil. And then, of course, chosen as the head of the EPA, if he is approved, Scott Pruitt, the Oklahoma Attorney General, who has sued the EPA 14 times, not for doing too little, of course, but for engaging in any kind of regulation. You've met with the president in this transition period, and I was wondering if you can assess this new climate and our new president.
That was a long story you told there. I do want to begin by complimenting you, Amy, for the power of the stories that you tell and that you make possible for other people to tell, and you do a wonderful job. And I made a mental note in your first comment, since there are so many filmmakers in this audience, I wanted to note that the Oscar for An Inconvenient Truth actually went to Davis Guggenheim. I have visiting rights to the Oscar, but he was the director, and we had a wonderful team, courtesy of Jeff Skoll, who has created an amazing business model. And I wanted to note also that it's interesting to me that President Nasheed and I are here partly because our stories have been told by two extraordinary directors, Monty Cohen and John Chink, who are here in the audience. And you were going through that list of recent news stories and developments, and I was getting a little PTSD from the early days of the Bush-Cheney administration, and I remember feeling that when a new outrage came up, I got to the point where I had to download some existing outrage in order to make room for. We don't yet know how this story of the new administration will unfold. And there have been, for those of us working on the climate issue, and by the way, I also wanted to say a word about Bob Redford. I said this at lunch, and it's true. While I was still learning about climate, Bob Redford was already acting on the climate issue to try to help solve it, and what has been created here at Sundance is extraordinary, and I want to circle back to that. We don't yet know how this will unfold, but those of us who've been working on climate for a long time have encountered a long string of obstacles, and now we do have another one. But President Nasheed said earlier that it's an economic story now. And I think the power of that economic story may well overcome the old narrative of a climate denial versus the truth. They have already adjusted to have a uniform new script that tries to avoid the label of climate denial, and they've reached a way station that my friend Dave Roberts, who writes for Vox, calls lukewarmism. and yet that is a way station from which further change may be possible. But the hopeful story of what has developed in the last decade since An Inconvenient Truth came out, is that the cost of electricity from renewable sources, principally solar and wind, and now the cost of energy storage, principally in batteries, and the cost of hundreds of new efficiency technologies that are not as well known but are transformative, all those costs have come down so rapidly that they've created a new world of opportunity that is irresistible for business and industry and investors. The sustainability revolution that is now unfolding in the world is in the historical sequence of the agricultural revolution, industrial revolution, information revolution, but it's unique in this sense. It has the breadth and scope of the industrial revolution, which completely transformed our world over a century and a half or more, but it has the speed of the information revolution. It is happening extremely rapidly, and it is changing everything. The latest contracts for electricity from solar panels signed within the last 6 months are coming in at less than 2.5 cents per kilowatt hour. And for those who don't follow these these kinds of metrics, that is less than half of the cost of electricity from burning coal. Now, the power of the fossil fuel industry built up over the last century and a half. And by the way, we still rely on fossil fuels for roughly 85% of all the energy the world uses. But during that long period of its dominance, they have developed a lot of wealth and a lot of political power that they are now wielding to try to hold back this sustainability revolution. Indeed, I think part of President Nasheed's story is that this family that pushed him out had the contract for diesel fuel in the Maldives.
In the Maldives, yeah.
And their source of wealth to sell diesel fuel as the fuel that produced all the electricity in the Maldives was threatened by all the solar panels that President Nasheed was installing. And that's kind of the underlying story of the struggle that took place there. We have our own version of that exact story here in the United States. There are places, in fact, you could take the state of Utah as an example, where the fossil fuel burning utility has used its legacy, political and economic power, to put nearly unsurpassable barriers to solar and wind. In Wyoming last week, some legislators introduced legislation to make it illegal to put up a solar panel or a windmill. Now, surely to God, that won't pass. But in Florida, the Sunshine State, Florida Power and Light, the biggest utility, has made it illegal because they control the legislature. You know, that's another story that we can get into, and maybe we should. But if you want to lease a solar panel for your roof in the Sunshine State, no, you're violating the law because the fossil fuel burning utility makes the law with puppets in the legislature that do what they want because they are completely beholden to them for the money that they need to get elected. I'm going too long, but may I make one other point here? The power of story is what we're talking about here. I would like to add to that narrative the power of deciding which stories get told, the power of setting the agenda. The genius of Sundance is that it is a meritocracy, and independent filmmakers who don't necessarily have access to the resources of the big studios with the new ever cheaper technology of these great new inexpensive cameras and editing tools are able to make amazing stories and then show them to audiences here, and the merit is judged by the collective wisdom of all the people who see these movies. Writ large, that mechanism used to operate in the United States of America. You talked about the kitchen table, a metaphor for where families get together and make decisions however they do. The public forum is the kitchen table for nations. The Greeks innovated the Agora, the Roman Forum, and the short-lived Roman Republic. And when the printing press completely transformed the way people communicated in the world, it triggered the Enlightenment and elevated the significance of reason. And here in the United States, we became the avatar for the possibility that nations could be based on principles and stories could be shared in a meritocracy. That information ecosystem was displaced by television in its broadcast iteration, and then cable and satellite. And all of a sudden, gatekeepers charged fees before you could get into the public forum to tell your story. So all of a sudden, the power to choose which stories were told went to the people who had enough money to control that. The internet is now displacing television, and the future of our ability to decide which stories get told depends on moving the forms and institutions of our democracy onto the internet as quickly as possible, creating tools to deal with these echo chambers, to deal with fake news, and to make sure that we have the ability to find stories that ring true.
So your thoughts, you've devoted many years now to telling people the story of climate change, to warning people about what is happening. We now have a climate change denying president, proudly denying it, calling it a Chinese hoax. And I'm wondering what your thoughts are and what you said to him when you met with him, and how we move forward from here.
Well, as you may know, I still feel that it's the appropriate thing for me to do to protect the privacy of that communication and subsequent communications, because I think it's always better to have the opportunity to communicate so long as there is a chance that it will do some good. And as I said before, we have yet to see how these chapters will unfold in this new administration. The events of yesterday give me a great deal of hope. I think that part of this story, underreported, as you mentioned, is that we are seeing the beginning of the biggest outpouring of citizen activism that we've seen since the Vietnam War. Mm-hmm. And we have to translate it into action.
And I'll just push this one last question around the Secretary of State, because this is truly unprecedented. The choice of Rex Tillerson and your thoughts on the head of ExxonMobil just resigned a few weeks ago to become the Secretary of State of the United States.
Yeah. ExxonMobil has financed climate denial. And every year they say they have stopped. And then when the funding reports come out at the end of the year, we find that they have continued. I think what ExxonMobil has done is deeply unethical. I think that in a world where other choices would be possible, we would have a different person selected for Secretary of State.
Well, he hasn't been confirmed yet.
That's correct.
Well, Jeff Skoll, you have been involved with documenting Vice President Gore's activism and have had a profound effect on the way people see how one person can make an enormous difference. Can you talk about why you chose film as your medium? If you had a transition point in your life where you decided this is a way to change the world?
Well, first off, Amy, thank you very much for convening this panel, and it's an honor to be here with so many of the people who have actually led me down the path to be, you know, part of the storytelling generation. And it, you know, I grew up in Canada in a middle class family, and we would often go camping for the summers. And there, you know, I wasn't much good at hockey. I was small, but I made up for it by being slow and uncoordinated. But I was a good reader, and I read a lot of books that talked about the future. And it seemed to me that the world of the future might not be, you know, as bright and prosperous as it had been for my generation. And in Canada, of course, a staple show that every Canadian knows as David Suzuki's The Nature of Things. So I grew up sort of camping, reading books, watching David, and you know, learning a lot about the world. And I thought, boy, wouldn't it be great to be a writer to tell stories that could get people interested in the biggest issues in the world and help them get actively involved and engaged. Didn't think that would be the best way to make a living. I had, you know, just after college, I'd actually never been on a plane, but I got a one-way ticket to London, and I started backpacking all through the world, and it took me pretty much everywhere, all through Europe and Africa and the Middle East, and back through the U.S. and the South Pacific and South America and so on. And I realized that there were a lot of things that I saw along the way that just didn't make a lot of sense. You know, I think about just the entrenched poverty and health issues that were in places like, you know, Mexico City or different parts of Africa, and how that those things could, you know, immediately jump on an airplane and affect all the world. And I figured, well, you know, pandemics are an important thing, and we need to get ahead of this. I think about at that point, the U.S. and Russia had nuclear weapons aimed at each other, and you know, they had a lot more back then, but they're still too many, and they're on hair trigger release. And I think about Pakistan, where, you know, that was like a country even in the 80s that was very divided and contentious, fundamentalist religion, air so thick you couldn't see your hand, and with nuclear weapons. And I thought, well, this can't stay, this can't be a good thing for the future. So I decided to be a writer, and to do that I went to business school. coming out of business school, joined with a friend of mine named Carol Midyar to start eBay. And lo and behold, about 2 years later, you know, eBay did pretty well. And the fundamental premise of eBay was that strangers could trust each other to do the right thing. So, you know, at one point in the transaction, you're paying money to somebody you don't know for something that they've represented online as it should be, and then you send that money and you hope the thing comes. And in the early days, everybody said, you can't trust strangers, it's not gonna work. And so we just kept going, and the company was profitable, so we didn't really need you know, to take outside money. And anyway, the principle that if you give good people the opportunity to do good things, they will. So I then revisited, you know, with this blessing of the resources that came with eBay, what could I do, you know, beyond writing? What could I do? And I thought, well, a way to reach mass audiences was through the power of media, so film and TV, and eventually, you know, other forms. And you know, if you think about it, the movies are so effective because we're in a darkened theater. We're not multitasking. The words, the images, the sounds come through, and they get past the conscious guard, and they actually help you kind of see the world in a different way. And just before I started Participant, I'd spent a lot of time with academic studies showing at that point, you know, circa 2003, the best way to affect change in a mass way was through movies. So with that as an idea, I marched down to Hollywood and figured how hard could that be. And you know, met a lot of people who had great ideas of what a social impact movie might be. One studio head suggested Legally Blonde 2 might have been the right way for us to go. But we from the start had a little template of the most pressing issues in the world, environment, health, human rights, peace and security, social and economic equity. And we sat down to make compelling entertainment that would get people engrossed in the stories that affect us all. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how we came to do An Inconvenient Truth, a little bit about An Inconvenient Sequel, and then sort of tie it back to the next stage of The Power of Story. In 2005, I had gone to a conference of Nobel laureates talking about science, and one of the four tracks was environment, and there were different parts of the subject, but climate change was part of the discourse. But I left Jordan, the conference in Jordan, thinking, well, climate change is gonna be bad, but we don't have to worry about it for 30 or 40 years. And literally flew into LA, and Al was doing his light show presentation at CAA headquarters, not CIA headquarters, but CAA in LA, and it was the first time I'd seen his presentation, and it blew me away because it became clear how urgent the climate crisis really was, and I saw it and I felt, gosh, Al can do these presentations one at a time to 100 people at a time, but maybe there's a better way to get this out. And right afterwards, Al and I and Davis Guggenheim, along with Lawrence Bender and Lori David, went to a little room at CAA and decided we wanted to make a movie based around Al's slideshow. Al said, that's the dumbest idea in the world. But Davis Guggenheim, who was running documentaries for Participant at the time, thought it was a great opportunity to tell a story and get out of being a vice president at Participant. So he went off and directed An Inconvenient Truth. By January 2006, we came to Sundance with two documentaries, the first of which we thought was going to be a global phenomenon, the other we thought would go straight to PBS. And the one that we thought was going to be a global phenomenon was The World According to Sesame Street, and the one that went and went straight to PBS, and the one that became a global phenomenon was An Inconvenient Truth. And over the years, having watched Al, worked with Al, and seen him he's been at this every day, and he was at this long before we connected and told the story. But the effects, this got climate change onto the radar, and before the movie came out, the American public felt climate change was an important issue to the tune of about 33%. After the movie came out, it was to the tune of about 87%. And then we watched with horror as the front organizations for disinformation came in and sort of twisted the truth, and the recession hit, and then all of a sudden people weren't as concerned anymore. Along the way, Al and I had been talking for some years about doing a potential sequel. In April of 2015, we realized we were coming up on the eve of the 10th anniversary, and we felt that was a good time to refresh folks on what we had talked about 10 years ago, what Al had talked about, and the scientists had talked about, and what had really happened. Were we right? So were we wrong? If so, how? But also what else was new? And a big part of the story that had really emerged over the last 10 years, besides unfortunately being right on a lot of the climate issues, was just the emergence of renewable energy. And Al talked about the cost and adoption curves of solar, wind, or solar and battery, or wind and battery, as just being this unstoppable force. And at the same time, there's something universal about, everybody wants clean air and clean water. They want their children to be healthy. They don't want their energy supply to be cut off by somebody who has the control over them. And you know, they want security, that energy supplies are not in the hands of people who mean us a harm. So and better still, you know, taking all the health effects and the safety and security effects out of the equation, to get to a point where it's actually cost neutral or cost beneficial to take on clean energy. Well, we've now reached that point where for much of the world, clean energy is the least expensive power source, period. And it will be for almost all of the world within 5 years. Left to its own, we'll have a global clean energy architecture by around the year 2040, which is a little too late, so we need to speed that up. But the big difference between the first film and this one is that the first film sparked a conversation. Now we have the solutions, and with Al as our fearless leader and all of you contributing all that you do, we have a great opportunity to win this war. And you know, new administration or not, the arguments for clean energy are just so powerful and have such momentum that we will win this battle.
Well said.
And remember, I hope you're preparing your questions or comments. But David Suzuki, going to another Canadian, you began broadcasting in 1962, but you didn't train as a broadcaster or a journalist. You're a scientist.
No, I'm a scientist.
So can you talk about why you went from your beloved field of science to television, and when you took on the issue of climate change?
Well, part of the reason I went into television was purely self-interested. I had come back from 8 years in the United States getting my degrees, and so I came back to Canada as this hotshot scientist, and man, I was gonna make my mark and become famous, and got into having to apply for a grant. And the people I graduated with from the University of Chicago were getting grants in genetics of 60 to 80,000 a year. And I got a grant for 4,000. And they said, you should be happy because usually we give 3,500, but you had a year of postdoc, so we're giving you. So I said, look, Canadians must not understand why science is important. Science, when applied by industry, medicine, and the military, is the most powerful factor shaping our lives. And if you're scientifically illiterate, you're not going to support scientists, but also you're not going to know enough about science to have input in how science will be applied to affect our lives. And so I was offered a chance to do a television, and it was a local channel, a television show, and I ended up doing 8 programs on genetics in 1963, was broadcast. And that got me, I realized, even though it was called a boob tube back then, I realized this is a very powerful medium of education. And so I kept getting drawn further and further in until ultimately I gave up my lab and went straight into to television. And it was such an honor when I was asked to host a long-standing series called The Nature of Things, started in 1960, the longest-running series in Canada. And I took it over when it became an hour program, looking at science, technology, natural history, medicine, the way these areas were being affected today. We did our first program on climate change, we called it global warming, back in 1989. And I just want to remind you that in 1988, a guy ran for president of the United States and said, if you elect me, I will be an environmental president. You know who that was, Alan? George H.W. Bush. There wasn't a green bone in his body, but he said it because Americans had put the environment at the top of the agenda. And I interviewed Brian Mulroney, was re-elected as prime minister. He appointed his hottest political star, a man named Lucien Bouchard, as a minister of the environment, moved him into the inner cabinet. I interviewed Bouchard. I said, what do you think is the most important issue facing Canadians today? 1988. He said, global warming. Man, I thought, whoa, that, I said, how serious is it? And these are his exact words. It threatens the survival of our species. Mm-hmm. We have to act now. So the public had got it, the politicians had got it, and a group of climatologists meeting in Toronto in 1988 said this represents a threat second only to all-out nuclear war, and called for a 20% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions in 15 years. That was the call. That was it. The scientists had said, the evidence was in, this is how we can get off the path we're on. And what happened? Brian Mulroney himself, who was the prime minister, never released, he first asked the committee, can it be done and how much will it cost? That committee came back and said, yes, we can achieve it. It's gonna cost $70 billion, but you will save a net $150 billion. That report, which has been duplicated in Australia, in the United States, in Sweden, was never released in Canada. Why should Brian Mulroney invest $70 billion and get hammered by everyone for all this money he was gonna spend, and someone else 15 years later take credit and say, we saved it? It's just not, the political distance is only from one election to the next. And there's nothing in it for someone to do the right thing so that someone else will take credit long after that person's out of power.
So David Suzuki, today, just in the last few weeks, you've written a piece, Five Things We Must Do Immediately to Stop Humanity's Collision Course. Very quickly, go through them.
You know, I can't remember what those are. That's very, very, I write this thing every week. I'm not gonna get off on it. Why don't you read it and tell me what it's.
Here, hand this over to him.
I would like to tell a different story.
Okay.
And that is how.
This is your chance to frame your story.
As you know, the Anthropocene, the period when humans have become the dominant force shaping the chemical, biological, and physical properties of the planet on a geological scale. And so the question is, how the hell did we get? We're one species out of 10 million species. How did we get to be so powerful? So as a geneticist, I've been intrigued by the way people can use DNA to trace the movement of human beings over time. And all of the trails lead back to Africa 150,000 years ago. That was our birthplace. I can't wait for David Duke and the Ku Klux Klan to invite me to give a lecture so I can say, look, we're all Africans, for Christ's sake. What's your problem? That was our birthplace. That was our habitat. But for some reason, we moved out of the plains. We began to move. We don't really know why. Probably population began to grow, resource depletion. I like to think teenagers were looking for action over the hill. We made it with Neanderthals, you know, so maybe they were trying to check the action over the hill. But anyway, we began to move. And as we moved into new ecosystems, we saw big birds with no wings and slow-moving sloths, and man, they tasted good. With simple tools, we were a very effective predator. We were an invasive species. We came into these new ecosystems, we had no idea how they worked. And we began, and you can follow a wave of extinction of plants and animals as we moved across the planet. And eventually, as we moved into new places, people said, what the hell is going on? Those big birds, they're not as many around. Yeah. So you got two choices. We've got to go find some more, or man, we got to live in a different way. And I believe that the roots of indigenous knowledge all over the planet are the people who said, we're staying. And remember what our ancestors did. They screwed up here. They made mistakes there. Hey, that worked over there. All of that knowledge, hard-won knowledge for how you live on this planet, became the basis of indigenous knowledge that is thousands of years old, will never be duplicated by science. And we grieve for the rate of species extinction. I grieve for the rate of loss of indigenous knowledge and language. because that is priceless. Mm. And it's not an accident at this moment. Canada, this year, is celebrating its 150th birthday. Pretty young country. But all across Canada now, you're seeing Indigenous people leading what environmentalists have been fighting for years. Not helping environmentalists, leading it, because they are the ones with the perspective about Mother Earth and what we've got to do. Standing Rock is just the latest iteration. I'm sure it's been going on all across the United States. But in Canada, we've had Burnt Church, we've had Elsie Bucktalk, we've had the Coastal First Nations, all the boreal communities have all been fighting for their place. And so I'm saying at the 150th anniversary of Canada, we've now got an opportunity to turn and ask the people that we've tried to stamp out to lead us in a different way of seeing our place and showing us what it is to live in balance. So it's in Canada, a very, very exciting moment.
I wanted to open up.
Amy, excuse me, I don't want to interrupt, but I have more to say.
Yes, okay, go ahead. Yeah. I was actually going to go to the tribal chair and have you comment.
Okay.
Would that be okay?
I just...
Because you didn't get your full chance.
Yeah, I didn't come here just to sit up here and look pretty. there's just some things that I want to contribute, because I think that what Dr. Suzuki was saying is really important, and I think that what has been happening at Standing Rock is very important, and certainly it's been a really important part of the last 5 months of my life, but I've also spent about 30 years working on these issues as an Indigenous activist and a storyteller. And in the last couple of years, one of the things that I've been doing is traveling throughout the Americas and delivering a lecture called The Decolonization of Consciousness. And I've traveled throughout South America, Central America, Mexico, the United States and Canada. I speak Spanish fluently, and I've been in villages in Chiapas and countries in South America and throughout what we know as the Americas, essentially engaging with people through in a conversation about the last 450 to 500 years and what's been happening within, you know, these countries and these continents that we inhabit. And one of the things that I've really come to understand is that over the last, you know, this kind of 400-year thrust that we're experiencing, it has been a kind of 400-year run of genocide, slavery, which built a foundation for industrialization moving through all of the natural resources, coal, uranium, oil, all of this, and moving us into this kind of, you know, multinational corporate exploit. And we just got the bill, which is climate change. Mm. And so climate change has really significant roots in genocide and slavery. It's sometimes astonishing to me that as Americans in particular, that we don't understand that what we have right now is because of slavery. Slavery then and slavery now. And I think that the dismantling, or the decolonization, if you will, but in particular the dismantling of these genocidal systems is the thing that will actually begin, that's actually engaging us at a level we can have a conversation, we begin to see the potential healing of our planet. But I think that the way in which this kind of run of colonial, this kind of neo-colonialism that we're experiencing over the last few hundred years, it is literally the thing that set the stage. And I don't feel like that we're really talking about it. I don't think we're really talking about the fact that British and American imperialism are destroying our planet. And it's something that, you know, particularly as an American and myself who descend from two different worlds in this conversation, I have African blood as well, but as an American looking at the world that we're in right now, that, you know, as somebody who has ancestors that immigrated from, in my case, Ireland for the most part, but as someone who comes from ancestors that immigrated from Europe into this country, that I have a responsibility toward reparation and reconciliation. And it literally needs to be at the forefront of the conversation that we're having. And as a person who descends from some of the original inhabitants of this country, well, I'm here. I'm standing here. And I think I feel that as Americans, we just, and as Canadians as well, I include in this, I think it's, and Australians and New Zealand and, you know, all the people that come, but I mean, Europe set out to colonize the world 500 years ago. And one of the things that's really important is that I don't think we oftentimes realize that before Europe set out to colonize the world, it first colonized itself. And so the descendants of the lost tribes of Europe are the people who are actually, that are, make up this kind of legacy of a colonizing spirit. And we need to be finding our roots and reconnecting. We need to return and we need to indigenize in a certain sense and be returning to these original essential ways. So instead of living in countries that are governed by law, which I consider a fallacy, because you look at this country, that is a country supposedly made of law, with treaty law being one of the five types of law, and there's never been a treaty honored with the original nations of this land in the Western Hemisphere, not one. So this country is based in fallacy. And so if we start to look at the idea of law, the law in which we should be living in accordance with is natural law. And that's the only law that we should really be in accordance with. And so I think that, you know, even talking about the election, for example, and for someone who my consciousness in many ways is older than America, but I look at the election in a lot of ways, it isn't surprising because he represents the descendants of the people who formed this country. I mean, he just literally represents the people who made this country. I called my mother the next morning after the election and I said, gosh, can you believe it? And she said, Heather, neither one of those candidates ever mentioned us. They never mentioned us. And so it's something that, you know, as we invigorate the conversation around climate and how we're going to create a future for ourselves, I think we have to be talking about these systems of supremacy that have shaped the world as we know it. And speaking to the entertainment community, you know, of which I'm a part of, and so are all of you, I mean, Hollywood generates 80% of the world's consumable media content in film, music, and television. Hollywood generates roughly 80% of the world's consumable media content. If you look at the world, it's about 4.5 billion people are Asian, 1.3 billion people are indigenous, just over 1 billion people are African, 600 million people are European. Like, we're in an industry that is creating a completely inauthentic view of what the world is. The entertainment industry is a systemic expression of white supremacy. And we're not talking about these kinds of things. We're literally just pretending. And we're just pretending that somehow all of this is just kind of is what it is. And it's simply not true. We have to be in a space where we're actually talking about these kinds of things and actually being willing to dismantle these systems. And so Standing Rock becomes something that in so many ways, and it's so wonderful to have you here at Chemin, I really want to thank you for coming to Utah and coming to the Sundance Film Festival. Because the movement that you were a part of leading on your lands for your people literally has altered something in the universe. There's a new possibility for our future, because bringing indigenous people into the conversation in a real way is authentic to the world that we live in. And it's crucial at these times. It's devastatingly crucial. And so I'm sorry to interrupt, but I just felt like I had something else to say.
No, you didn't interrupt. If we could bring up the lights, we don't have much time for all of your participation, but you know, Democracy Now! Has been covering the Standing Rock standoff first from afar. It started April 1st with the first resistance camp that LaDonna Brave Bull Allard opened up her property on the Cannonball River and then expanded it to more, and then it expanded to more and more resistance camps, and thousands of people went to North Dakota to take on the $3.8 billion Dakota Access Pipeline. This is as the election was getting more and more intense. There were primary debates and then the major election debates. And through all of this time, as this historic gathering was taking place, the largest unification of Native American tribes in many decades, over 200, 300 tribes from South America, the United States, and Canada, there was not one question asked by a debate moderator of any of the candidates, right, not only of Standing Rock, but of climate change at all.
Second election in a row.
So Democracy Now! Went to on Labor Day weekend to Standing Rock, which is actually late into it, that we were covering it before and talking to people. And what we found there was this horrifying scene soon after we got there. Native Americans walking up on an area that they were going to plant tribal flags, didn't think that the company, the Dakota Access Pipeline, would be excavating on this Labor Day holiday weekend, but they saw the bulldozers going at full tilt. They came upon the land. They had said that this area was sacred burial ground and sacred sites overall. And they tried to demand that the bulldozers pull back, and they did. The bulldozers pulled back, but the Dakota Access Pipeline guards unleashed dogs and pepper spray on the Native Americans. Our Democracy Now! Team was filming the dogs' mouths and nose dripping with blood of Native Americans and the Native Americans' horses. They ultimately pushed those bulldozers back. We posted that video online. I don't know if Winona LaDuke is here, but she said that day, Governor Jack Dalrymple, the governor of North Dakota, you are not George Wallace. This is not Alabama. This is 2016. We're through. That video went online and on Facebook within 24, 48 hours, 14 million views. People around the world were intensely interested. Just a few hours before we covered this, when we first arrived, we went to the main resistance camp, and who was there but the tribal chairman, the 45th tribal chair of the Standing Rock Sioux tribe, Dave Archambault. And he was there with many youth who were there, people gathering, welcoming different Native Americans from all over the Americas. And he is here today in the front row. And I thought, before we end, it's absolutely critical in this period where we don't know exactly what will happen, but what we've seen is a resistance that has led to over 600 arrests. Chairman Dave Archambault himself arrested, strip search, put in an orange jumpsuit. As the pediatrician of the Standing Rock Sioux tribe, Dr. Sarah Jumping Eagle, the same thing was done to her, and this is par for the course, the basic denigration of people in jails in Mandan and in Bismarck, the capital, where they themselves have said no to the pipeline. Ultimately, President Obama on December 4th, 5th, said no to granting the final permit for the pipeline to build under the Missouri River before an environmental impact statement. But where this goes now, it is not clear. And that's why it is especially wonderful to have Tribal Chairman Dave Archambault himself here to say what you feel might happen now, what your what the Standing Rock Sioux are demanding, what you're most concerned about right now, and how people here can make a difference. Yes, we have a microphone. And can we turn up the lights here?
Come on stage.
Why don't you come up on the stage? Right over there.
You know, I just think about what it takes to make change. And when I look at the panel, including Amy, you know, it takes a lot of courage to make change and to be a change agent. And you guys reap that courage. And I'm so thankful, Amy, for you kind of giving a background and being there for us and telling the story, as well as Vice and the Sundance Film Festival for helping us with the story. And like this panel's about story. And I'll share kind of where we are. And then I'll just kind of follow up on what you said as far as our culture and what we believe and why this needs to be told. So Standing Rock has, we're in court. The way I look at it is we're fighting this in several fronts, and there's a lot of people that are owed credit. It's not me. So we have, legally, we've been fighting this thing, and right now today, after Obama's administration said we're not going to give the easement to cross federal lands. The Dakota Access Pipeline filed a lawsuit, filed a brief saying, give us the permission. We believe we already have the permission because we got the permit. So in order for them to get a permit, there's different statutes that they have to comply with. So first one's Clean Water Act permit, Clean Water Act statute. And then there's the Rivers and Arbors Act. And then there's the Minerals and Leasing Act. So they got permission off two statutes, but they didn't get the Minerals and Leasing Act to cross the federal lands. And we've been asking them to stop, don't do this. Huh. And don't give them the easement. Don't do an EA. Consider doing an environmental impact statement, because if you do an environmental impact statement, you start to realize what this nation should cherish. And it's the original occupants of these lands that have our language, that have our culture, that is has our heritage, that's special. That we've been here, and we've always been here, and we're not going anywhere. So we need to do an environmental impact statement and study that. This is something that we had asked for 2 years prior to any of the movement. We've been saying, don't do an EIS in this location, or EA, environmental assessment, do an environmental impact statement. It feels like you talk to people who have no ears. Nobody listens. For 2 years, nobody listens. And it wasn't until this movement blew up where the Corps of Engineers and the federal government start saying, hey, something is not right. We have to stop, and we have to pump on the brakes. And they did, and we're thankful. And in order for them to do that, when the Obama administration came out with the EIS, that took courage, because you're going up against a system where the federal laws allow for something like this to take place. All the federal laws are there, and we knew from the beginning that we didn't have a fighting chance, but we have to do something. We knew that the laws are in place for them. We knew that they had the permits, but we did it. So where we're at today is the EIS. This past week, we got a notice of intent to publish it in the Federal Registry, which is something we've been hoping for since the statement came out. So this past week was a huge week for us, because when they said they wanted to do an EIS, the Department of Army, immediately Dakota Access Pipeline filed a suit, or filed a brief saying, we need to stack these. We came back with arguments saying, you can't stack statutes on top of each other. You have to comply with the law. And if the Department of Army is not going to give you that easement under the Mineral and Leasing Act, you can't say you already got the permission under the Rivers and Arbors Act. You can't say you got the permission under the Clean Water Act. So that's what we're waiting on right now. On January, 17th, the Department of Army came out with a notice, preliminary notice of intent. And immediately, Dakota Access Pipeline filed a temporary restraining order not to put it in the Federal Register. And the judge, so this past week, Judge Roseberg denied that temporary restraining order. So this past week, I was happy because things feel like they're going our way until January 20th. When we get a president that, who comes out saying he's in support of this, and there's just a feeling that you have to hold your breath and hope that he allows this process to go through, this environmental impact statement to go through. So that's where we're at legally. Politically, I ask for meetings with the president just to help him understand some of the things that are important to us, some things that we cherish, and why there is resistance. And that goes back to the story. So life is simple. You know, when I listen to everything, it seems like we just have so much in our heads, and we're thinking so hard. So it's so simple. So in our culture, if we look at our culture, we say, if you see something moving out there, wherever you are, that is, it has a nari. We call it maka shka shka, something moving out there, and it has a nari. Nari means it has a spirit. So if it has a spirit, it's connected. And we have another word we say, midakya, say we're all related. It doesn't mean that I'm related to you guys. It means that our spirits are connected. Not just our spirits, but our spirits with all beings. Whether it's grass, animals, trees, anything that flies, they have a nagi. So we're connected. And we had this relationship for thousands of years where these spirits help us. They give us the medicines that we need to doctor ourselves. The other simple thing about this is there's four things that these beings need. And they're sources of life. It's not a resource. So we need a source of life, and they're here for us. They're here for us to use, not to abuse. So water is a source of life. Air is a source of life. This earth is a source of life. And the sun, the fire that never ends, is a source of life. If you have those four things, we can always live. So we have to start, these, our beings have to build relationships with the sources of life. And we have to respect them, not abuse them. So that's how simple life is. And we don't have to complicate it anymore. We just have to remember what is it that gives us life, and let's cherish it, and let's take care of it, and we'll be okay.
Thank you, Chairman. I'm wondering, Vice President Gore, your thoughts on the Dakota Access Pipeline.
Oh, well, I've spoken out many times in support of Chairman Archambault and the Standing Rock Sioux Tribal Movement. I think I've publicly labeled it an atrocity. And I do think that, as Heather said, this is a moment that is filled with possibilities for raising awareness. I'm the short story is I am against it, and I think that the climate narrative that is particularly pushed by the younger members of your tribe and other tribes is really important. And I'd like to put this in the context of the other great moral movements that we have had in human history, because they all have certain features in common. The civil rights movement, the women's suffrage movement, the abolition movement longer ago, the anti-apartheid movement, the movement for gay and lesbian rights, LGBTQ community rights, all of them have this in common. When the underbrush is cleared away and the central question is resolved into a moral choice between right and wrong, then the outcome is foreordained because of who we are as human beings. And there was a great economist now deceased, Rudy Dornbush, who once said, "Things take longer to happen than you think they will, and then they happen much faster than you thought they could." The great American poet Wallace Stevens wrote in the last century, "After the last no comes a yes, and on that yes, the future world depends." The climate movement is now at that point. People are connecting the dots. As I've said before, every night on the evening news is like a nature hike through the Book of Revelation. People see what is happening, and they're beginning to see very clearly that this is a choice between right and wrong. We are not far from the point where the last no will yield to a yes. Midway through the last century, when we were at another point of decision, a turning point after the crisis years of World War II, that generation of Americans said, "Look, enough world wars coming out of Europe and Northeast Asia, enough trade wars, enough wars. Let's just try to build a world system that is based on principles and values." And General George Marshall said it's time we steered by the stars and not by the lights of each passing ship. In our culture now, there are lots of passing ships, lots of passing tweets, lots of distractions. Our whole culture is now replete with distraction. We spend an average as Americans of more than 10 hours a day now looking at electronic screens of one kind or another. And as the chairman said, we don't need to overcomplicate things. This is a question of right or wrong. It is wrong to destroy the future of the human race. It is right to give our children hope. We are now a global civilization, and we have to expand our awareness of exactly what is at stake. This climate issue challenges our moral imagination because it has a scale beyond anything we are used to dealing with. But it is, again, in the tradition of all the great movements that have spoken to our conscience. The story of climate is ultimately very simple. Will we choose life? Will we choose a sustainable future? I believe that the answer is yes, and the stories that can be told by this community can move us much, much more rapidly to that answer. For anybody who has any doubt that we have the will to act, always remember that the will to act is itself a renewable resource.
Awesome. Well, we want to thank this fascinating panel, and the conversations can continue afterwards. Thank you to all. Yeah.